Welcome back, everybody. I'm Dr. Marc Heeg with the Columbus Männerchor, and this is Dr. Marc's music literacy class. I want to welcome any new people that have joined in, and of course the students who've already been taking the course. We've got some exciting things coming up in these next two units. So if I remember, we're using Alfred Publishers Essentials of Music Theory as our textbook. And today we are in Unit 5. We're going to begin with Lesson 18. Now, so far you've learned some basic kind of image symbols to use to represent music and timing and so forth. We learned how to write notes on the lines and spaces and begin to hopefully you're practicing this, you're identifying being able to practice reading the notes quickly on the lines and spaces. But the important thing is you're able to recognize it and you write it, and somebody else who's music literate can read that and understand it. So you're learning to communicate your intentions in terms of the notes, the particular pitches that you want to use. Then we also began to work with time. So we learned how to measure time by putting the bar lines and different things in, which creates a space for sound events to happen, intended or non-intended sounds. And we did that with taking the apple, representing a whole note, and cutting it up constantly in half, and half again, and half again, till we got as far as eighth notes so far, I think. Didn't we do eighth notes? And so we've been learning to kind of hear and find those things, to beat rhythms, and to control the timing of things. Now, this next step is manipulating the sound, all right, in various kinds of ways. As I said, remember that the point of all of this music symbolism, all of these things that you're learning, is to become more and more able to more finely have a lasso on the neck of this great beast that we call music, so that we can control it in certain ways and get it to move the directions and at the speed that we want it to. So the next thing we're going to talk about is in this chapter, and unit, is how to carefully manipulate the sounds that we're creating. Different qualities of that sound. The first one in Lesson 18 is it with dynamics. And they refer to these things that you're going to look at, that you're going to learn as dynamic signs. But dynamics has to do with purely with the volume, with either loud or soft. All right. And before electric guitars hooked up to monster speakers that engineers are controlling with the little bars to go up and down, people had to do that themselves on instruments which didn't have that kind of amplitude possibility. But you could basically, to some extent, depending on the instruments, play louder and softer. And there were different reasons for doing so. So they had to come up with ways of explaining to people how to do that. So this says, dynamic signs indicate the volume or how soft or loud the music should be played. Most musical terms are written in Italian, since Italian composers were among the first to write music down, and they put their instructions in the manuscripts. The basic things that they want to say is the word piano in Italian means soft, and the word forte means loud. Okay, and you've heard that this instrument that I play is called the piano, but the word for it in many other countries is pianoforte or pianforte. And its predecessor from the 18th century was the opposite. It was called a forte piano. So the piano that Mozart played would have been called a forte piano. All it means is loud and soft, or soft and loud. That what was unique about this instrument, that it was finally a keyboard which could actually have differing dynamics. Because now the harpsichords will disagree with you about this, and it is kind of true. Harpsichords create more loud sound by combining more of the strings or putting both manuals. They have two manuals, and they put them together, and they can make, of course, more volume. It's just louder. But in general, the piano mechanism, as it was created by Bartolomeo Cristofori, allowed for a hammer to hit the string, and it was possible that depending on how hard you hit the hammer, that would be reflected in the way the hammer hit the string and would make it louder or softer. And that's why I developed that name. But these are the two most common words, piano and forte. And here you'll see they have a placard here which has the most common symbols in it. And in the music, sometimes you actually see the words written out. More than not, you're going to see an abbreviation for it. So what you have is the Italian word, the sign, and then the English translation. So they're showing piano and forte as P and F, soft and loud. And then this word that they use here, I'm going to try to find some times a way of helping you to remember the word, but mezzo. Think of the word mezzanine. What's a mezzanine? Mezzanine in a theater are the middle seats. They're between the floor seats, the orchestra seats, and then the upper balcony. The mezzanine was actually a very special place at one time to sit because that's where all the, well, if you had a king or a queen or all the nobles and people, they tended to sit up there. And then the wealthy business people sat on the ground floor and the common people sat up in the upper rafters. Well, mezzo means middle, right? So, or in this case, they also translate it as moderately. But you just think of mezzo as mezzanine. It's kind of in the middle somewhere. So mezzo piano means moderately soft, mezzo forte, moderately loud. And then they have this, I can't think of the word that I want, but it means the most, issimo. When you add issimo, it means very. So if you have piano, it means soft. If you have pianissimo, which they put as two P's, means very soft. Forte is loud, and fortissimo, with two F's, is very loud, right? So here you have soft and loud, moderately soft and moderately loud, which means that it's louder than just the P or the F. When you add the M to it, it means a little bit more, okay? It means a little bit more. And then this is just the opposite. You have PP and FF, which means either very soft or very loud, all right? Now, this is helpful too. This is, it says dynamic signs are arranged in order from very soft to very loud. Here they are. So you go PP, P, MP, MF, F, and FF. So it's pianissimo, piano, mezzo piano, mezzo forte, forte, and fortissimo. For your own advice, or for your own knowing, I've seen, it's not uncommon to see PPB and FFF, and I've also, in some rare cases, seen PPPP and FFFF. And they would be, of course, on the extreme ends of this example. Now, of course, with the piano, I think people know this. What's wonderful about the piano is that it could become suddenly louder and get softer. Suddenly, all right? So you can actually go from, I think the difference, let's put it this way, what's an honest thing to say? With a harpsichord or an organ, you have a setting, all right? And the instrument's set like that to play at a certain volume with certain sounds, all right? And then if you want to have more, then it tends to be a layered kind of thing, or a terraced dynamics, they'll call it, so that you can flip a key so that on the organ or the harpsichord so that both of the keyboards are activated. Or in the case of organ, you can have different stops that you've pulled and you set them in a way, in an old-fashioned kind of lock and key way. And once you hit that little trap, it will reset the organ so that different pipes or voices sound. So you can create different dynamics with the instrument, but it happens squarely, one might say. You know, you play a certain point and then boom, then you have loud again. But the difference with a modern piano, or even going back to Mozart's time, is that depending on the weight that you apply to the key when you put it down and the speed at which it hits the string, you can be instantly quieter or louder. Now, the way that they show that they want you to do that in the music is in this next little box. This says a gradual change in dynamics. These terms are used to indicate a gradual change in volume, in this case from soft to loud, or from loud to soft. All right, so this is one of them, all right? I think you've probably seen it. It's just, what would you call that thing? Rudy, I don't know what to call it. But anyway, it starts out at a point and then opens up, right? The Italian for that is crescendo, okay? Crescendo. And it can be just cresce, like that. Now, the interesting thing is, if you look at a piece of music, sometimes you'll see the sign, and sometimes you'll see cresce. It's entirely up to the composer what he does, and then to some extent, when the publisher gets a hold of the manuscript and starts to put together, he may have a certain way that he likes to do it and may change it. But it means the same thing. It means to get gradually louder. So it's, you know, you can see it makes sense, right? There's a little fine point, and then it opens up to show a bigger space on the other side. And that means it's just like turning the volume up on the radio, okay? Then you have the sign, which does the opposite. It's open on this side, and it's, remember, we read music left to right, Western music. All right, so it means that it's bigger, and it becomes smaller at the far end. This is either a diminuendo or dim, diminuendo, so we get diminish in our language from that, or decrescendo or decresce. All right, and as I said, you can either have this symbol, which will be in the music for getting louder or getting softer, or it might just simply say cresce here, or dim or decresce, which means getting gradually softer. Okay, so these are dynamic signs. I want you to memorize these things. I'm going to suggest that in general with these four lessons, it might help you to do what do you call the little cards?
Flashcards.
Flashcards. Make some flashcards for yourself. Put the information, maybe the Italian and the sign on one side and the English on the other, so you can then turn them around and do them both ways. But make sure you learn this and you learn these signs and the correlative terms that go with it. Okay, so for exercises, they write the Italian word for the following sign. No biggie, all right? Number two, and this is interesting, because you're going to start with your clapping, where you're doing ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, for example, or ta-ta. Now you're going to be doing that in terms of dynamics. So you're going to have to clap louder or softer. Clap the following line, observing the dynamic signs indicated. So this becomes a coordination issue. I understand that with you. But you can do it slowly. Let's try it. Let's say one, two, three, four. Let's say mezzo forte. Eh? So let's say that's a mezzo forte. This is a forte. And this is piano. Okay? So here we go. We're going to go one, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Okay? I suggest you just try it. You can also do it by doing the ta 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 the si ta ti ti ta ta ti 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 ta 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 ti 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 ta, for example. All right. Number three. This is fun. Use every dynamic sign learned above at least once to mark the appropriate dynamic signs on the lines beneath the following story. So what they've done is kind of cute. Wake up, whispered Ron to his brother Stephen. The boys walked softly out the door. They pretty much have the line underneath the word that they want you to associate with the appropriate dynamic marking. And when I saw the wake up, I thought, oh, forte. But then it says, whispered Ron. So he goes, wake up. Right? So how are you going to write that in terms of the dynamic? Here's a walked softly out the door. Here's faded away gradually, all right? It's kind of clever and fun way of using some literature to help reinforce this information. There's a certain amount of memorization that's going on in this unit of five. So I would suggest you practice writing them down in addition on your score paper. And really, I think with this kind of stuff, flashcards are going to work really quite well. Make them up for yourself. And if necessary, I think probably what I might be able to do when we do the Zoom class for this unit, we might, we haven't been doing this, but I don't think it's been so necessary, no one's asked. But we might be able to review some of the actual exercises that you do for your homework and practice certain things like the rhythm exercise with the dynamics. Okay? So it's your first lesson in dynamics in music. We'll be back for the next unit. Welcome back, everyone. We are at Unit 5, Lesson 19 now, on page 29 in your books. The previous lesson, we talked about the volume of sound, so just louder and softer, getting louder, getting softer. And now we're going to look at time. We learned how to manipulate time in terms of how many beats in a measure, what note gets one beat, if you're looking at whole notes, half notes, quarter notes, eighth notes. But now it's an issue of setting time at a certain speed. Is it going to be a fast time or a slower time? This is the really wonderful thing about music, because we really do start to play with time. And in a really great performance, what often will happen with people, they lose track of time. Musicians, when they're involved in making the music or practicing, even when I practice, sometimes I'll sit down and start to work. 2.5 hours later, I'll just kind of lift up out with my head out of the water, and it's like I just started 5 minutes ago. You lose a track like that. Or you think about these orchestra musicians or the conductor do these huge Mahler symphonies, and these pieces that go on for an hour without a break, or an hour and a half, Bruckner symphonies, you know, and they have this incredible concentration that just pulls them along. It's a wonderful experience, because unlike, you know, the workaday world where we're always looking at a clock and wondering when something's going to start and end, music has this ability to kind of shift those kinds of things. You know, Einstein was a great lover of great music, and himself wasn't a bad violinist. So we're looking now at tempo marks, right? Tempo is an Italian word meaning rate of speed. It's interesting, because they had a Ford Tempo in tempo years ago. I don't think they were really great cars, nor did they go that fast, but that was the idea they wanted you to have. And it probably worked more in the South American Hispanic-speaking countries than it did in the English ones. But tempo means a rate of speed. So tempo marks tell how fast or how slow the music should be played. And they're also, of course, written in Italian. Pretty much, let's just get ready. It's all in Italian. Now, by the time the rise of nationalism in music in the mid-19th century, you'll start to see, especially from Germany, German music markings for dynamic control or for tempo control, things like that. Schumann especially began, Robert Schumann used to use those quite often. And then, of course, the French, even before that, back in the early 18th century, and then again in the 20th century, when their music really started to take hold again, they started to use French terms to describe the way they want their music done. But in general, Italian's the international language, basically because the church ran the show for so many centuries, and as music became, from the Renaissance and after, more of something that was outside the church as well and accessible to the public, it was the Italian trained musicians who traveled the most internationally, and they ended up going all over Europe and taking their skills with them. So the most common thing was really string players out of Italy, who ended up all over the place. And I think it became convenient, because so many of the musicians were Italian speakers, that within the rehearsals in the orchestra, the people who led the rehearsals probably it was generally done in Italian. That was the lingua franca of music in a good period of its history. So we're going to look at slow to fast. Here we have another box, and again, I encourage you to to make up some flashcards. I'm not sure. Okay, largo means very slow. You know the word largesse? Largesse is a kind of a generosity that a very wealthy person has. In the way they give it to someone, it's called, you know, they're offering something with great largesse. It's a kind of very, oh, of course, you know, very easily, very, and it's very slow, you know, oh, come and just spend the day with me at my palace, you know, and we'll take a walk and we'll have tea and we'll have cakes. And we'll have this magnificent dinner that will go on for hours, and then we'll smoke and we'll have some brandy and, you know, all kinds of things, and we'll play with the ladies all night long, all this kind of stuff. And then, oh, by the way, let me give you that house out there on one of those properties somewhere. Largesse. But it's done in a very slow and easy kind of way. This is largo. Okay? It's a very stately and lovely tempo. There's a famous piece called The Largo from George Frederick Handel's opera Xerxes, X-E-R-X-E-S. And you would recognize the piece if you heard it, and it's very beautiful. And the title of it is Largo. Probably more common marking for a lot of slow movements. This would be true of Mozart's, lots in general of Mozart's slow movements in his sonatas or symphonies, is adagio. Adagio. It means slow. An adagio is appropriate tempo for like a beautiful, kind of slower, quieter, loving opera aria sung by a soprano. You know, just something that just soars and just takes its time so beautifully to unfold. There's some beautiful things. Just look up Mozart operas and adagios on YouTube, and you can find some beautiful arias that you'll see at that tempo. Then the next, still on a bit of a slowish side, but beginning to pick up a pace, is andante. I'm not sure what kind of word to ascribe to that from English, but it means moving along. It's kind of a walking speed, not race walking, just a very comfortable walk, you know, you're just kind of shuffling along, walking along. But the idea of the andante is that it's something that's moving forward. It's not quite so static or something that's kind of almost sitting in a way. There's forward movement, but not much. And then there's moderato, moderation or moderately. In this case, moderato is used for tempo markings, mezzo is used for dynamics, right? Moderato is moving along even a bit more, right? Moderato, let's see. Andante means you go out for a very comfortable walk at Inniswood Gardens, and you're just kind of walking. You have no time, you don't have to be anywhere later, and there's no point to the walk. Like, you're not doing for, you know, rush exercise kind of thing. You're just enjoying the woods and the trees and seeing the squirrels and stuff, maybe stopping once in a while to look at something. That's andante. Moderato, you've gone out on the boardwalk into the woods, and you realized, just a little bit, I feel like maybe I should have used the toilet before I started the walk. But it's not that urgent, so I'm going to walk the rest of the way through the boardwalk and take the little shortcut past the frog pond and go back and use the restroom before I keep walking. It's a moderate, okay? You get to allegro. It says quickly or cheerfully, allegro, all right? Let's use the same thing. You're out on that boardwalk and you suddenly get an urge, let's say you ate something you didn't settle with you, and you're going to have to need to use the toilet pretty quickly. Then you have to decide, are you going to go back the way you came, or are you going to keep continuing, but you're heading to the bathroom because you got to get there. And you're out in the middle of the woods at the moment on that boardwalk, and it's a little tight. So you're going to run, you're going to walk fast anyway. Definitely going to walk fast, okay? You think these are appropriate stories? You know, they get the point, Rudy. and then finally we have vivace, all right? And I think we have the word vivacious, you know? Umbaracha, you know, kind of stuff like that. This is lively and fast. Vivace is, as you'll learn eventually in music, is not the fastest tempo marking by any means. We have presto and prestissimo. Those will come later. But vivace is fast enough. And actually, it's interesting because the vivace does mean lively and fast. It's faster than allegro, but it has more to do with the character. You know, if you think like a really hot signorina, you know, though she's dancing the cucaracha, it's a kind of thing like that. And stuff like that. That's a vivace, okay? It's a very high-spirited. Tempo's tending to move pretty fast. You know, there's a lot of action going on. Great Cuban music that Desi Arnaz used to sing with his band on the Lucy Show, for example. All right, so put these things on flashcards, right? The Italian on one side, the English on the other. Practice going both ways, slow to fast, all right? Remember, I haven't said this yet. Moderato, as with mezzo, all right, moderato can be combined with other words. So, for example, you can have an allegro moderato. This is very common. Actually, you see this in classical music earlier, for example, Mozart and Beethoven. So what they're saying is that some kind of a tempo between the somewhat hurried and cheerful aspect of allegro, but it's just held back a little bit. Let's say an allegro might be the cheerful walking of a healthy, you know, striving young man of 28, right? The allegro moderato would be a similarly still strong and healthy man, but he's 42, you know? And you learn as you go along, I think, in the decades, that it's not as quite important to get there as fast as you thought. A little side thing like that, I used to talk to my dad, who was a very proud and strong Christian, and we were having a conversation about death one time, and he had Jesus' picture up on the walls. And I said, Dad, you know, the way we're talking, it's almost like, you know, you're a little afraid of death. And he looked at me and he said, no. He says, I know what I believe, and I know, you know, in my mind, I know what's going to happen after I die and everything like that. You know, I'm very confident about that. I'm just not in a big hurry to get there. So, that might be an allegro moderato, all right? Take your time hastening towards death, all right? A gradual change of tempo, all right? You have the same thing with time, with tempo, as you do with dynamics, right? You can be going at a certain speed and then you get faster. You can be going at a certain speed and then you begin to slow down, all right? And this is how we show, well, these are two terms that we can use to show that, all right? So the gradually slower part is ritardando, okay? Which can be written as retard or rit, right? And it comes in the sense of Latin, whenever you have re or re or ri, it means back, all right? And tardando, this means like pulling the time backwards, all right? This is, so pulling, this is, if you're riding the horsey, this, you kind of pull on the reins, get him to come back, all right? It means gradually slower, not an immediate stop. But it's the same kind of thing. Now, in this case, you'll see here, there are no signs as there were in the dynamics. These are always words that we use. You'll see these words generally appear at the beginning of the music or in an important break in the music. There might be a different change in the tempo that you want to use during that period of the piece. And then when you're changing it in the middle of the music somewhere, where with the signs you had this for getting louder, this for getting softer, they're only words regarding the timing. So for slowing down, ritardando is retard or rit. And then similarly for getting faster, getting gradually faster, is accelerando, okay? Accelerator on a car, accelerando, huh? And you write, most of the time you see accel. The composer doesn't write the whole word out. Honestly, most of the time, unless it's a big space where it's happening, the word won't be written out. You're only going to see an abbreviation like this. Okay? So you fill in some of the blanks on these exercises in writing the music. Tempo marks tell the boom, 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 boom. A very slow tempo marking is something. A lively and fast tempo marking is this. And then the number four, you're going to pull these different terms in terms of the letters, put them in the appropriate space where they're definition is. Okay? So that's a little bit of how we're controlling speed tempo in music. Thank you. See you in a moment. Okay, we are now at lesson 20 in unit 5. And we've looked at volume of sound, the dynamic sides, and we've looked at the rate of speed, which is tempo, changing the time in the music, right? And now we're looking at a term which might be a little bit out there or farther afield for people to understand right away, but you'll get it, because if you've ever sung or worked with a conductor or somebody to talk about articulating something, you know what articulate means. Articulate means to, more or less, I would say, to clearly communicate something to someone else. And it's the means by which you do that, the articulation, right? I am articulating very cleanly and carefully at the moment, right? You can even see that physically, the way I'm doing it, right? Pages 28 and 29 previously introduced the words and signs that indicate what speed, slow to fast, or volumes, soft to loud, a musical selection is to be played. In addition, notes can be performed in different ways, they say. Okay. The manner in which a note is performed is called articulation, right? So, let's see. A very slow, I don't want to, this is not meant to make fun of anybody, but if someone had a speech impediment, or they're not able to talk quickly. Sometimes if somebody had a stroke and they have problems speaking, right? That's a certain kind of articulation. They're doing the best they can given what they can do at the moment. Well, we got a guy who ain't drunk and he had too much to drink and he started to talk. His articulation is not so good, but it's very legato. It's very smoothly connected, but you're not getting things really crisp. So the articulation, I would say, if you look at it, slow to fast with tempo, or you're looking from soft to loud with volume, from less clarity to a very heightened sense of clarity is what you're talking about with articulation, okay? And I hope I didn't offend anybody by doing that. I'm not making fun of drunk people or people with speech impediments. God love everybody, they're doing the best they can. Here's our little box, which is going to teach us some articulative expressions and markings, and believe me, there's oodles of them, but these are some crucial ones. Okay, and we're getting, again, we're going from shortest to longest. Now the first thing that they mentioned up here before the box, though, is legato. We talked about legato on page 19 with ties and slurs. You remember that? You just finished unit 3. So the tie is the thing that connects the two same notes together, and the slur is the one that's creating an idea or a concept that you want, which is given by way of several notes being underlined. And it says that when they appear like this, the articulation is different in that they are played so that they can seem to be all connected together as legato. Legato means smooth and connected. Make sure you add that one to your flashcards. It's not in the general list, but it is the most common word that you're going to hear musicians use. Legato means smooth and connected. Now, let's start with the shortest one. You might have heard this word. You certainly may have seen it in music. The symbol is a little dot above or below the head of the note. It was in that image right there, you see? So that's different from when we had the dot after the head of the note. That has also to do with timing. You remember that increases the value of the note by 1/2. Well, in a similar way, actually, in the 18th century, what this dot meant over or under the head of the note is to decrease the note value by 1/2. That's originally what it meant in 18th century performance practice. However, now it's just become the idea that it's detached. It's not a long-held or a long-singing note. So, a staccato, it's called staccato, okay? You play the note short and detached. The Italian word means detached. So, if I play two notes, right? You hear them smooth and connected. this legato. If I had these little dots under or above the heads of these notes, I would play. That's a staccato sound, right? That's a way to articulate. Now, it's good that they stick to this with English here. Then you can also see we have a little wedge, right? Above or below the head of the note. It's called an accent. It means to play it louder with a special emphasis. So I'm going to play again, legato, staccato, and then I'll play with the accent. The accent has to do, in more sophisticated interpretation, not just with the duration of the note, so that it's short but a little bit longer. It also tends to really be looked at by sensitive musicians as having more to do with timing, the way that you would articulate the note more than it does with dynamics, because it can also be used as a dynamic thing. But let's start with legato. Here's legato. Here's staccato. And an accent would be, right? There's just a little bit more length from this. And it's both a sound thing and a little, but it's not. Right? The important thing with this articulation, and some of this stuff is going to begin to appear in the ear training parts of the lessons. So those of you who haven't been joining yet because you thought, I know this stuff really well, I don't need to do it. I've heard a few people say, I'll start joining the Zoom class when, there's stuff there that I don't get and I can use the help. That's going to start to appear, I'm pretty sure, even in this unit. We're going to do some ear training things that are emphasizing these different concepts, especially the articulation and volume. You might want to join in and begin to hear that, because it's ear training. It's not just a test. Actually, it's more of teaching you more of to really begin to hear this stuff, which, of course, is an important thing in music. All right, then you have here in the middle what they call sforzando, which is written as an SF or SFZ. Sforzando, a sudden, strong accent. The Italian word means forcing. Okay, forza, all right, is force, and ando is a, what do we call it, a gerund in English. It was with the ing part added to the verb. Sforzando, it means to, it's forcing it, right? So if there's a difference, let's see, here's a legato. Okay, and we have the accent. Listen for it. Those moments like that, and then a sforzando is. Right? It's longer and it's attacked a little bit, so that it's suddenly strong, sforzando. Okay? Then I'm going to show you these next two, tenuto and fermata, against a very short articulation. Tenuto. Tenuto is from tenere, tenere, which means to hold. All right? And it's marked by a straight line either immediately above or below the head of the note. Okay, so you see this? We have staccato. We have the accent, and we have tenuto, which can also be written as T-E-N. That's one where the composer might actually write a word instead of, or the abbreviation for tenuto, instead of the sign over the note. It means to hold the note for its full value. The Italian word means held. And that's more or less like the legato, but it's absolutely, there's no space in between. I see the word tenuto because it means to hold. It can, if you think of it, it comes off as a tender way of holding onto something. Think of the way that you would hold the baby, all right? You don't want to jar the baby at all. So it's not just legato. This to me is legato, all right? And this is tenuto. Actually doing on the piano is I'm actually playing one note, and when I'm playing the next note, I'm still holding on to the previous one, then I let go. Play, let go, let go, let go. Alright? And it creates that sense, kind of an overlaid, overlapped kind of sound, which is like legato, but there's more to it than that. And in my mind, it's because tenuto, I think of tenderly holding on to something, that it has a feeling of being more special. When you're young and you're in love and you met your partner during the middle of the day in college and you're holding hands and then you have to let go because you're both had to run across campus, go to different classes, that wanting to hold on to that hand just a little bit longer, that kind of feeling, you know, that has a deep meaning to it. Then we have fermata, okay? This is the little bird's eye. Right? And you'll notice that whether the stem is going up or down, whether the head of the note is up or down, the fermata is above the note. Okay? It's above the note in every case. Hold the note longer than its normal value, approximately twice the normal duration. This is an articulative thing, but it's also a timing thing. All right? Actually, I mean, you can look at all of these in a way. It's connected in a sense with timing. You know, and that their note duration is being affected. All these things with articulation are affecting the durational value of any note. The fermata is the one that holds in the longest. You've seen them before. Sometimes at the end of a piece of music, or the end of a section where they want you to hold on to it. It's something that will stop the flow of the music for a little bit. And it's called a fermata. No, it's not a big deal. It's kind of, it's a little bit kind of like a double bar, the function of the double bar. It's the, kind of the end of a thought or the end of an idea or the end of a moment, and it's held and then you move on. Or you could be done. Okay, so we have anything from the shortest, which is staccato, which originally in the 18th century meant to have the value of the note, all right? But now it just simply means detached, all right? And moving all the way up through these guys, the fermata, which pretty much doubles the note duration. When we're counting it out, we at least do twice what it says. So this instead of being 1-1, be 1-2, 1-2. Okay? For exercises, pretty straightforward. Just write out in the Italian, whatever these symbols are. What do they mean? And then I like this one. Number two, say the following examples using the syllables T. Remember T, 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 T for the eighth notes? Ta for quarters, ta for half notes, and ta, yes, ta for dotted half notes, and ta for whole notes. Observe all tempo markings, dynamics, and other musical symbols. I know, this is becoming a bit more complicated to do, but I thought I'd do the first one with you. Okay, I'll set the tempo for us. Notice we have, let's say these first by ourselves without regard for anything else. This is ta, 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 ti, 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 ta, 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 ti, ti, ta. This is a fermata. So it gets two beats usually as a half note. So technically, this is actually a ta. It's four beats because there's a fermata over it. Now, look at these little guys. What I would say is for a normal ta, let's go ta, ta. Okay? Make sure it's ta, ta. But these are going to be ta, ta. Again, at least half the value of the note. So this would be ta, 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 ti, 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 ta, ah. And then these are not detached. So this is ta, 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 ti, ti, ta. You're going to have to make a little bit more sing-songy, longer sound. And then you're going to have to make it a little shorter because of the staccato. Now, here's what I said. Piano at the beginning, and then you have piano moving to forte. Okay? So this is how we're going to do it. Here we go. Two. Oh, it's actually four. Let me change to two. Okay. Two. One. Here we go. Ready? One, two. Here we go. Ta, ta, ta. Ti 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 ta boom. Ta 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 ti ti ta. Okay, let's do that again. Ready? I'll beat it with it. One, two, here we go. Ta 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 ti 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 ta. Ta 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 ti ti ta. Okay. For example, that's your exercise. That one, for example, I may do with you in the ear training part of the Zoom class so we can practice these things together. I know this is going to take a little more time. I've debated whether or not to separate these lessons into like 2 weeks instead of one. But I'm going to go ahead and have Rudy release them for the whole week once they're released. But we'll talk about it. You know, I'll start to gauge where you're able to stay on with things. But I know that we're beginning to put a whole bunch of different things together with these exercises. We're putting together the note values. We're putting together the beats. We're putting together, see, this is an allegro too, which actually I didn't do. An allegro should be more like ta, 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 ti, 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 ta. Ta, 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 ti, ti, ta. That would be more an allegro. I didn't even do that with you. So you're going to have to look at the allegro, the largo, and the moderato. If you have a metronome application, you'll be able to begin to see what the recommended areas of beats in terms of tempo are for any of these words. They're actually marked. From the oldest times, from the tick-tock, tick-tock, tick-tock metronome, there would often be, the words would be written in different places with as the numbers are inscribed on the other side. And it'll give you kind of an idea of the neighborhood. This is a largo neighborhood, this is a allegro neighborhood, this is a presto neighborhood. And so we're mixing a whole bunch of things together, and I know that's difficult. And I know for some people, that's like trying to walk and chew gum and do this thing at the same time. So do the best you can. And as I said, we can actually review these exercises if any of you want to do that during the Zoom meeting. Okie dokie. That's why I put a whole hour aside instead of what we've been doing, which is 25 to 30 minutes mostly. Okay, that's as far as I can tell. It for lesson 20. Hello again, everyone. We're in Unit 5, Lesson 21. And the signs and the terminology that we're going to add to our wealth of knowledge refers back in a way to Unit 4, Lesson 14. So you will remember when you were introduced to the double bar with the dots on it, which is the repeat sign, and then where they're together and how that music is repeated, and you learned first and second endings. So this is about going back and doing a certain portion of music until that far. For example, with this one, you sing the first two lines, da 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 da, di da da da, and you go back, da 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 da, da da da. Okay. Well, we have other ways of denoting things like that. And these are, again, shorthand. They're easier sometimes in placing a whole bunch of unnecessary stuff in the music. This is especially useful when the composer just wants to repeat a great deal of information that you've already heard the first time, but he wants it said a second time. And it's very interesting. Why would they do this? It has something to do with a concept of architecture and the structure in the music and the way the ideas have to be heard. And something very interesting, going back from Beethoven and backwards for sure, and to some extent 19th century musicians did this as well, but especially from Beethoven back. Beethoven, Mozart, great performers, were renowned improvisers. So they were the jazz artists of the day. They were the Keith Jarretts of the day. Sit down, play whatever the hell. What was it, Herbie Hancock? You know, anybody like that, just it'd go off. Somebody go, play a riff on this. Bach was famous. A lot of Lutheran organists became very famous for, somebody would give them a theme. Da-dee-da-da-dum. Now that wasn't one of Bach's necessarily, but what the organist was challenged to do was to start to play that, and then they'd improvise on that theme. There was a great professor at Wittenberg University when I was attending there named Frederick Jackisch. Every one of his organ recitals, at the end, he would have asked people to write down possible melodic constructions on their program and submit them during intermission. He would review them, and then he'd pick one of them, and he would put it up on top of the organ and announce it. This is the one that I'm going to do. And then he would go off for 10 to 15 minutes, 20 minutes, and play this miraculous piece of music that incorporated the idea that the person had. These people were able to improvise, and it was only during really a specific period of time in the 19th and into the 20th century, and in the present day really, especially since we've involved in a sense archaeology in music, in that we go back and we dig up the old stuff and try to either just play it, or then we introduce performance practice where we're trying to figure out this is the way they played it, and then we recreate that and do it. But the truth is our music, most of our history, has been contemporary, present-day music. Mozart only wrote and played his own piano concerti, wrote all this music. Why did these guys write so much music in their short lifetimes? That's because once people heard it once, they didn't want to hear it again. I heard that one. What's the next one? You know, it only became somewhat common in Beethoven's lifetime that they repeated some works, and that's because a lot of people hadn't heard them, or they're too long to listen to at one setting, or they're complicated enough that like, I didn't get it. I need to listen to it again. That they started to do that, but in the classical period, well into the 19th century, you'll find often that in sonatas, symphonies, first movements of string quartets, they have a certain portion of music, and then they go back and they repeat it. And then it goes to a next section, and they often will repeat that. Then you'll have a middle section, which doesn't usually repeat, and a finishing section, which will repeat some of the opening information that you got, but it's changed in order to end in the right key. What we don't tend to do often in our performances now, historic performance practice might do that, when they play the certain beginning of information and then repeat it, they put ornaments and they improvise, they do things to it. Right, and that was what was expected. The reason to repeat it is to give the people a chance to hear the ideas again, but they're ornamented, you know, they're changed a little bit in some kinds of ways. So this would explain why they'd say, I just go back to the beginning, play it over again. But there was a reason, and they wanted you to dress it up, you know, make it your own, you know, show your stuff. That doesn't get done in what's become traditional performance now. So to reduce the amount of music needed to notate a piece, come on, these guys are using ink, quills, paper. If they're wealthy enough or have a little bit of money, they're hiring copyists to copy out the parts and everything. That's expensive. You know, it's expensive. It's time consuming. So they want to do as much as they can. Again, music is shorthand. You know, as much as they can possibly find out, not to have to waste time or money or resources, they're going to do some kind of shorthand version. So you think that lady or that guy that's ticking off this stuff in shorthand in court sessions. Can you read that stuff? I can't read that stuff. But some people do, and they're doing it where they can write out all the stuff that's being talked, and they have a system, kind of probably like music, as shorthand, which is able to capture the information sufficiently that people can understand what's wanted, what needs to be said. Several additional Italian words and symbols are used by composers to indicate repeats. So this is mostly all about that previous lesson in repeating. You have da capo. Da capo means from the head. So, da capo or DC, you can see it either way. It may be written out, or you might just see DC. It means from this point, and what's going to happen? You're going to go through DC. All right, and there usually might be like a partial double bar line or something, meaning you got to go back. What it means, we're back, all the way to the beginning, to the head, okay? Da capo, back to the beginning. The next one is dal segno, which is DS. So you've seen this in music sometimes. This is very important. Ruby will put this up for you so you can see this funky little sign. It's like a fancy S with a line through it and then dots on either side. I have no idea what the origin of that is. I have some thoughts about it, but that's that sign. That's the sign when it says dal segno. What that means when he uses this is there might have been 4 or 8 measures or who knows at the beginning of the piece. No, I don't want you to repeat it from there. I want you to repeat it from the 9th measure and then keep going. Okay? So that means when you're reading the music the first time, you're going to play digga 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 digga, and then you come to the 9th measure and you're still playing. But up there above the 9th measure is that funky S. Okay? Well, it doesn't mean anything the first time. But then what you're alerted to, though, is you're going through the music. Oh, I'm going to go back there. I have to go back there to repeat. And you finally, you'll get in the music and you'll say DS or dal segno. And boom, you go back to measure 9 and repeat it and do it forward. Okay? Then the other two terms that you're learning are conclusions, all right? This one's pretty common. Fine. Is written as fine. That's it. There's no abbreviation. The end. So you've seen some old-fashioned time films back in the early days when they moved from theater into film, especially the French guys. They put fin, F-I-N, at the end of the film. It'll just be fin. That means that's it. Nothing else. You know? That's it. So fine means the end. Now, the reason that it might be there, because, for example, like down here is a double bar, right? So we've already talked about that. The double bar is the thing that appears at the end of a movement or the end of a piece of music, which means the end. That's the end. Okay? You'll learn that there are some movements of music that have additional information that goes through to an end, but it's not the end. And what you're going to do is you go back and you repeat and you play some stuff and you'll get to a certain place where it says fine. That's the end, all right? Fine, whenever you hit fine, fine is the end, absolutely. Now, if you are playing a piece of music where you have some music and you repeat it, have some different music and you repeat that, and you go through, and you see that fine thing, you're gonna keep playing because there's still music to read. Keep playing through all that music. Maybe repeat some of that internally. Now, at the end of that part of the music, it's gonna say, in some cases it won't because it's understood, you have to go back, but in many cases, say da capo. Okay, go back to the beginning. And then for reasons that you haven't learned yet, you won't do those repeats internally, but you'll play all the way through until you get to fine. And fine is absolutely the end. What is it like in Monopoly? What's the card that you get? Don't go past this or that or something. Stop there. That's the spot that you have to stop on. That's fine. Okay? So it means the end, but it's usually not going to be like at an end of the piece of music, because that's obviously shown by the double bar. It's when you have music that goes quite a ways out, and then he wants you to repeat, and then the actual end of the music is somewhere in the middle of it. That's where he wants you to stop playing. He'll put a fine. Last word, coda. Coda comes from a word which means tail, all right? And the coda appears as, it might say coda, or it might have this kind of big fat circle with a cross in the middle of it. Rudy will put up a thing on the screen so you can see very clearly. Plus, it's here on page 31 of your book. It's an added ending, okay? So you've seen them before if you've been singing in your choir. We do some music, we do a repeat, and then you're gonna see this sign, all right? And it may see al coda. All right, or coda. And it means that from this point in the music, since you've gone through and then you repeat it this time, I want you not to continue through the music, but go from here, from this measure, boom, to the end of the piece where there's an alternate ending. That's the coda. It says, when the coda sign appears in the music, it means to skip, which I just said, skip directly to the coda section, which is an added ending, usually marked with the same sign, the circle with the cross inside. It'd be interesting to look it up, because I don't know what the origin of those things are. I mean, over the years, you just learn it. Okay, now this is interesting. These are exercises that are also teaching you how to do these things. So the Italian words and symbols for repeating are frequently combined. Here you go. DC al fine. This is like the thing I was talking to you about. All right, it means repeat from the beginning and play to the end. So here's how you do this music. It says, number one, you play this all the way through to the end, and then you return to the beginning and you play to fine. All right, for example. So this is ta, ta, ta. Boom, boom. Ta ti ti ta ta ti ti ta 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 ta, boom boom, and you finish. Okay, so there's the da capo al fine. There's a dal segno al fine. All right, this means repeat from the sign the dal segno al fine, and play to the end. So I'm going to play from the beginning. Do all of this through that double bar because it's fine in the middle. It's not the end. There's more music. I have to go all the way here. Then I go back to the sign and go to fine. So this is in three. So this one would be da. Ta 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 ta. Okay. Once you practice these anyway, I'm showing them to you now. This is da capo al coda, right? Da capo al coda. Repeat from the beginning and play to the coda. And then you skip to the coda. So this time we're going to go all the way through to music. Then this is da capo al coda. So we go back to the beginning. We're going to do the first two measures. And we skip. This is like a cut to here. And we do that one. So this is ta 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 ti ti ta 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 two, and ta 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 ta, boom. Okay, that's the example of that one. Then we have dal segno al coda, so you're getting the handle on this, right? You repeat from the sign and go to the coda, then you skip to the concluding ending. So we're going to go all the way through this music to the double bar. Then it says dal segno al coda. So we're going to go to this one. Then we're going to go to the coda. And we're going to skip this measure and do this one as an alternate ending. Okay, so that one is one, two. Ta, 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 ta. Repeat. Ta, 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 ti, ti, ta. Okay. This takes a little thinking, takes a little, gonna have to practice. Let me tell you something I saw recently on Facebook. I thought it was very good. Reactions between the audience member and the musician. And so this person is saying, oh, that was so magnificent. It was a magnificent performance. What a gift you have. It was just fabulous. Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. It was just a lot of practice. And then the person keeps going, oh, you're so brilliant, you know, you're so gifted. How do these ideas come to you? How do you do this? You know, it's so miraculous. Well, thanks. It's just a lot of practice, really. And then they keep going and says, oh, I could never do something like that. You know, I could never play that like you. You're just so magnificent and fabulous and everything. And the musician says, yeah, practice. Okay, so that's what it comes down to. It's a really nice thing to be a musician. One of the great self-satisfying things about it is working out the problems, keeping your brain active. It's like doing crossword puzzles or something and figuring these things out. But then there's this soulful, wonderful musical stuff going on. Keep your hands moving. I mean, look at these concert pianists and conductors, how old they get, you know, before they croak, because they're keeping their minds and their bodies, you know, active and moving. And it's a responsibility, a thing that we have. The better you get, the more that is expected from you. The more you can do, the more personally enlightening and fabulous the experience is to just make the music yourself, but then you can share that with other people. But the way that we do things, you know, it's one of the things, and one other thing, they find that the two professions which require the most dedication and the longest period of time in practicing are physicians and musicians. Both of them go through a tremendous amount of schooling, years of it, before they're ready to do their thing. And then they finally, you know, start working professionally, but they have to do it constantly all the time and keep honing and refining everything. So that, would you rather have a fresh 32-year-old surgeon or a healthy, you know, guys take good care of himself, but a 50-year-old surgeon work on you? Why? Well, think of all the more people that he's worked on, and all the more people that he's worked on who didn't die, you know? And for that matter, you know, it's fun sometimes to hear a late, vigorous, in his late 20s pianist play, but think about that versus one of the great performances of Horowitz or Rubinstein or Claudio Arrau in their 70s. You know, you're hearing people who are like philosophers who've come to a great, deep understanding of the music that they can bring to you. But what they all have in common, practice, practice, practice. Thank you. That's the end of Unit 5, Lesson 21. See you next time.